got a mask.
We need to put that on. I'm sorry.
Thank you, baby.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table for me.
Is our refuge and strength, a very pleasant help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved, To you, O Lord, I call my mom. Be my death. Lest that you be silent in me, I my soul, who go down to the cross. Hear the voice of my pleas for mercy, when I cry to you for help, when I lift up my hands toward your most holy sanctuary. The Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? The Lord is my stronghold, and whom shall I be afraid? When evil doers fail against me, to eat of my flesh, and my adversary and foe, it is they who stumble and fall. Though an army is in a camp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise against me, yet I will be confident.
resolutions. Romans 12:15 reads, rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. The family of Bryant Webb would like to sincerely thank all of those who are rejoicing in Bryant's well-lived life and those that are also mourning with us in the transition of a man that we all love so deeply. We offer our heartfelt thanks to the many family, friends, neighbors, and well-wishers who have provided emotional and practical support for us at this difficult time. For those who telephoned, sent messages of condolences, traveled long distances, streaming this service live, the Osceola High School class of 1988, and Bryant's Nike North America Transportation and Trade family, we are truly grateful. A numerous amount of cards and floral tributes were received. Thank you to those individuals and families as well. A special word of thanks to Reverend Moses Black of Bethlehem Baptist Church and Pastor Broderick Conicero of the Common Church in Memphis, Tennessee. And to those who loved and helped us in any way, your contribution made our loss more bearable. As it would be impossible to thank everyone individually, please accept this acknowledgement as an expression of our deepest gratitude. Amen.
Expressions of the father, Mia and Matthew Webb, followed by the uncle, Kevia Carter, Brittany Johnson, Reagan Webb, Kendall Grace, Desmond Coates, Donovan Coates, Jasmine Coates, and then the brother, Bernard Webb, Yolanda Webb, Tiara White.
Thank you. difficult to find words to say about our uncle, who for some of the family that stand beside me right now, he was also like a father. You could always count on him to crack a few jokes, to pick with his loved ones, to take a whole tray of his sister's devil eggs, and give great life advice. He knew what it meant to be present and active. Many of the people here can attest to that. He's been at graduations, weddings, births, and just whatever random get-together that we had. He showed us what it meant by pushing us to be the best that we could be and to be better than himself and his generation. He was no nonsense when it came to handling business, but he never hid how proud he was of each and every one of our accomplishments. If anyone needed to talk, he would make that time to make that happen. And if he felt the need to say something, you better believe that he'd find a way to do that. That's just who he was. He was big on family, not just the blood ties, but the friends that become like family, the additions by marriage and birth. We would miss the way his presence filled up a room. We would miss the way he tears up and laughing too hard. But most of all, we would miss the love that he shared with each and every person in this building right now. It was truly a blessing and nothing short of a gift from God.
In months like Father Figures in my life, he's, you know, easily, you know, up there. Along with my, you know, my own father and my grandfather, like, he's up there a little screen. It's so many things that I want to say thank you to my friend for. You know, one thing about Bryant is like his love for dogs. He loves training them. I remember, like, as a young child, he used to tell me this story, which, you know, he was watching me, and my dad was falling asleep. And apparently, I took the whole bag of dog food and poured over his cages with his dogs, Taylor and Ramsey's. He told me that the dogs, like, ate all that food, and he was, like, and they were pooping all night. And through my interactions with him, me seeing his love for animals, it gave me the same love. So much so the fact that, you know, I decided to go to veterinarian, become a veterinarian, and right now I'm in year 3 of vet school.
Amen.
And when I got into vet school, he always joked, he's like, "Hey, Desmond, when you become a veterinarian, you want to treat my dogs for free." I pay for the meds though, but you know, it's gonna be for free. I'm like, okay, ain't it for you? You know, but besides from that, like, the thing that, you know, he taught me that stuck with me the most is the concept of a man's word. Margaret Bryant always told me that, you know, the greatest thing that you always have is your word, because that's the only thing you can take with you, you know, when you pass. And, you know, and my Uncle Bryant, like, he exhibited that very day means. Every time he said he's gonna be somewhere, he was there.
Right.
No, every time he said he's gonna do something, he did it.
That's right.
I never once had to doubt anything he said, because I know the end day, he will do it. And me seeing his drive and his commitment to that, his word, made me want to be the exact same way. Hence the reason why, if I tell people, you know, I love you, I really mean that I love you. If I tell people, if you need me, I got you, I really mean, if you need me, I got you. If you need me to be there for you, I'll be there for you. And that's something that my Uncle Bryant taught me. And for all these lessons that you gave me, I want to say thank you, Brian. Because without you, I would not be the man who I am today.
For us to pay tribute today to a very special person, our brother. Bryant took all the roles in his life to heart, and his mission was to always honor, support, and guide, and most importantly, to protect us. His devotion to our family was the foundation of his actions, the anchor that defined and shaped his life. He was the happiest when we were all together, and we're together all the time. Our family celebrates, like Justin said, our family celebrates everything, and we've never really needed a reason to get together. When I met my husband, who was raised as an only child, I really think that he thought that something was wrong with us. Because we talk and text every day, throughout the day, and about everything. It's not uncommon for us to connect 2, 3, or 4 times a day, even if it's just to share a quick joke or a laugh. I'm glad that we've lived our lives this way, because I know we haven't left anything unsaid. Brian has been a good friend to so many, and he's been our best friend. We've always been able to talk to him about anything he could be counted on and depended upon, always. Whether we needed simple advice, a shoulder to lean on, or just someone to listen, he's been that guy, ready, steadfast, willing, and always fun and funny. Because he wasn't willing to settle for less, he has lived a very principled life and had a strong sense of right and wrong. He loved God and was always searching for scripture, studying to understand and know more. He had a quiet faith that guided his actions, words, and deeds. Like our parents, Brian has always been a superhero to us. He taught us a lot, and he expected a lot, but he gave so much more. He has been such a significant part of our everyday life and who we are. Right now, I really can't bring myself to say goodbye. Can't imagine how it would be even later today when I won't have heard from him for the 6 days straight. This is something that we will truly have to learn to do one step at a time. Indeed, he has prepared us to live out his legacy of being a great parent to Matthew, Mia, and all of his nieces and nephews, for being a great son and a great friend. Out of all the lessons that he has taught to us, this lesson, learning to live without him, will be the greatest. Brian, we want you to take your rest. We're going to miss you so much. We'll always remember you with love, respect, and admiration, always.
So I guess they say the best for last, right? I can get up here and I can say a whole lot about my brother, my role model, my icon. But there's one thing I can say is that I feel that he stayed on earth long enough for us to get stable and get our life together. Because I had a rough patch in my life. And he used to always argue with mom and daddy in London.
Nate used to always argue. But I thought I knew everything. And Brian's thing was, his saying was, my thing is this, or you brought in yourself. So therefore, when they encouraged me to go to rehab, which I am proud, I went. I just feel like Brian pushed me after I got out to maintain this lifestyle. I thought this lifestyle was boring. It's not boring. And when you talk to him on the phone, he wasn't a phone guy at all. He'll say what he had to say, okay, bye, and hang up. But Saturday night, I had posted a picture of me and this baby picture, Logan T baby picture, Bird, Greg baby picture, and Lil Sam and Mario baby picture. And he texts me, he texts Priceless or something. And then he called me, he said, I don't need no cable. I just go to your page when I want to laugh. So therefore, he said that. He said, okay, bye, love you, and hung up. Then he called me back. He said, I love you, proud of you, bye. So that's confirmation, you know. A lot of people don't get that. See, there's some stones that people don't turn over until it's too late, or try to turn over until it's too late. We a type of family to where we talk, we know we love each other.
Come on, God.
Ain't out of my mind that we love each other. Yeah. Right? So, and I don't want to say I wish I could have one more conversation with my brother. Because we said what we had to say while he was here. I'm not going to be over there jumping that casket trying to drag him out. Because if I do that, that means it was something I need to let him know. Or something I feel guilty about. I'm not going to sit here and be like, I wish I can go. I wish it was me. No, I don't. Because I got grandkids now. He left up with me. It started with that man right there with the shield on his face. It started with him. That's the perfect role model. Brian got it from him. And he blessed me to keep me in line. It was hard, but he got me there, y'all. He got me there. So I'm gonna tell my brother, job well done, brother. You are properly leading to your duties, because I got this. I got this.
I didn't want to say it.
Good afternoon, family. Being a family means you are part of something very wonderful. It means you will love and be loved for the rest of your life. Amen. No matter what. I believe that Bryant embodied every aspect of the love of and for family and everyone around him. I want each of you to know that I love you and that I'm standing heart to heart with each of you today. When we leave this setting, I want you all to take with you the courage to heal another day. The joy in knowing that the memories of Ryan will live on in our hearts and in our minds. Amen. And most importantly, the love that he obviously had for everyone in here today.
Yes.
Family, know that it's okay to cry. And know that it's okay to be hurt. Yes. But in knowing these things, also know that we won't hurt forever.
That's right. Amen.
For this too shall pass.
Amen.
And the days will get easier.
Yes.
Family, moving forward, let's stick together.
Yes.
Pray together.
Yes, Lord.
pray with and for each other, and continue to truly, truly love each other. Sometimes you don't realize your own strength until you come face to face with your greatest weakness. God doesn't give us what we can handle. God helps us handle what we are given.
Come on, kid.
I pray everyone's strength in the Lord today.
Amen.
Can we say praise the Lord? Can we say praise the Lord again? To God be the glory for all that he has done and for what he's going to do. Truly today I honor all the clergies in the house. I honor all the saints of God and all the sinners too. When I looked on the program, it said celebrate the life of Brother Webb. Celebrate. Y'all know how we do when we get together to have a celebration. Amen. We don't be sad. We don't cry. We enjoy each other. Before I give you a scripture, I want to remind you that Brian is not here. He's not here. This is the house that he used to live in, that he moved out of the other day. He wouldn't come back here now if he could, because to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And that's what we live and strive for, to be in his presence. You're going to be in the presence of him or the presence of the devil. So we strive to be in his presence. Family, I want to comfort you with a word from the Lord. He said, come unto me, all ye that are labor and heavy labor. And he said, I give you rest. This too will pass. Not gonna tell you don't cry. It's human to cry. But you know what makes me happy today with my family? I've been in the funeral home business 38 years. And then when I get an obituary and it read, they was of the song. Of the Baptist faith, that mean they weren't nothing. They weren't in nothing. And then they talk about she left a very good friend. No, they was housekeeping. Place of telling it like it is. I want you to know that God have not treated you unjust. It was once appointed to die. After death will be the judgment. And we're going to spend eternity somewhere, either with God or we're going to spend it with the devil. Hell is real. I don't care who tell you it ain't. When you read Revelation, that hell is enlarging itself. I don't care who don't believe in Jesus. That's your prerogative. But I dare you to die without me. I don't care what the eulogists say, that you in heaven, it won't make it real. There's a barbecue in hell, and don't you care to meet. Family, love one another. Comfort one another. death ain't never accident. But they died an accident then. No, death is a sure thing. When we are born, our bounds is set. And he said, you cannot pass. And then we, Brian, have moved beyond the if. He be saying, if you had done this, if you had done that, if, his time was up. Sure we cry, sure we gonna weep. But I want my family to know that I have sit in that seat that you're sitting in for years with a mother that was murdered, with a father, with three daughters, sisters and brothers. And if he brought me through, he gonna bring you through.
Amen.
I want you to know that life and death is in the power of the tongue. When you give God a life, you can get what you want from him. Learn how to speak life to yourself. I know you heard, but this too will pass. When we go to the cemetery and leave there, your burden's gonna start to lift. Sure, we're gonna remember it. We will have our moments. But remember the old saying, God won't put no more on you than you can bear. God ain't putting stuff on folks. Devil is. He said, above all, I wish that you would prosper, be in good health, even as thy soul prospers. I want to say to my brother-in-law and sister-in-law, that's Matthew and Exie, you've done a good job in raising your son. You gave him the best of life. You see to him getting education. You fed him good, took care of, laughed at his nonsense jokes. Now he's resting. He's in the hands of the Lord. And Mike and Ed said, God gonna take care of you. He gonna comfort you in this hour. So hold your head up and be strong and thank God for the time. We don't own our children. They are lent to us for a season. And I want to say to my crazy nephew, God bless you, son. I want you to know Uncle proud of you. You talk to me a lot of time, but you finally got it together. And this is what life does. Life is just a baby. We don't take no chance on life because we don't know where death is. And then, see, Brian didn't die. He just went to sleep. He's just taking a nap until the trumpet of God shall sound, and those that died in Christ will rise first and be changed. And everybody that don't hear that first trumpet, your ticket will be to the barbecue. Anybody listening to me as the pastor getting ready to come forward, I want to remind you, if you don't know Jesus, you better get to know him before you die. If you're not a churchgoer, put your mask on and go to somebody's church. Don't worry about who's right and who's wrong. You just get yourself right. They ain't right in your house and you ain't left. They ain't right on your job and you ain't quit. So if you wrong, one more wrong won't make that big a difference in the church. I don't care what you do, how drunk you get on Saturday night, get your drunk self up Sunday morning and get to somebody's church. And you might hear that at last advice like us and staying like that. I didn't come to make you love me. I come to scare the hell out of you. What scripture says your eyes and your ears always will be. A place where you say your people that are called by your name will humble themselves, seek your face, pray, and turn from wicked ways. And God, your word says you'll hear and forgive. So God, as we are here in this place, we acknowledge that you are God, and that in this time of retrospect, in this time of celebration, we realize that God, it is all in your will. And so now, God, as I come to the part in which I speak, God, I eulogize this life of Bryant Webb. Pray, God, that everything that you desire to be heard on this day would be heard. God, the individual in here, God, who needs to know that if there is a decision that needs to be made here on earth so that they can see you in heaven, I pray right now that that eye be open, that that ear would hear, and that that heart would receive. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
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 There's a saying in the black church, let the redeemed of the Lord say, amen. And so real quick, if you don't mind, if you know, that you've been redeemed, can you just say amen?
Amen.
Amen. To the family, I am very much honored and humbled by this opportunity. Funny for me because, like you all, I had my encounters with Bryant, and there were three things that I will never forget in my sessions with him, because he made it very clear for me, the pastor. One, that I needed to be punctual. Two, that in that moment he was going to be present. He was listening to everything that I had to say, but it was important that I was present while he was talking. The last thing that he made clear to me every time we finished was he made me aware of whether or not there was purpose in the stuff we talked about. And I kind of took that, y'all, and kept that for every other session after him. I get mad now when people late. My wife will tell you I start writing out and scripting out, because you know black pastors, we can counsel folks and don't have no outline or nothing. But Bryant Webb made me get an outline. And that's one of those good things about it. But what I'm clear about today, and I say this whenever I do a funeral, is that the eulogy is not for the man in the casket. And so while you are here and you are mourning, you are crying, be very clear that whatever comes out of my mouth, this is God's conversation with you. And again, I'm not going to act like I'm some psychic and I'm
prophet of the time. But be very clear that if you are here, it is ordained. And that is God's will for you to be here. Before I even read the scripture, let me just go ahead and set the table so that everybody's here. Because I heard it echoed a few times as I sat. And so it's interesting to me. Let me do protocol. Pastor, thank you to you and this beautiful church for this opportunity, for your gracious kindness to allow me to be in your office and to sit in your seat. Thank you. But I'm clear about this moment, and I'm not going to be before you long, that what God wants to say to somebody in here is simply found in this statement. It's a matter of time. A matter of time. What's interesting to me, I'm gonna talk to you. I'm one of the preachers that gotta lock in on somebody. So me and you about to have a conversation. They get it. But okay. Me and you gotta be here. It's interesting to me, brother, that in life we hear a lot of sentiments about time. You got some folks that get on this tip and, you know, somebody finally tells them how they really feel, or they finally do what they're supposed to do, and they look at the person and they say, it's a fine time now for you to tell me. And then there's some folks who just make a whole lot of mistakes, and they always telling you, if I could just turn back, the hands of time. But then there's some of us that come to a maturity and we come to realize, like I believe Bryant did, that time waits for nothing, but everything in life has to wait on time. I could go deep and I could go theological and talk about time. And talk about how in the book of Ecclesiastes it talks about there was a time for everything. I could talk to you about in the book of Genesis how the Bible defines and declares time by day and night. And so for you and me in the creation process, it's important for you and me to understand that time meant something to God. That's why he created it. And like anything that God gives you, anytime you mistreat it, anytime you take it for granted, it's a crime against you and not God. One of the other things that Brian helped me with when he would come and hear me preach is that if I said something profound, he wanted me to know. Because he was an intellectual person. We had to talk about preachers, and he didn't do well with those that had no substance. You had to say something to strike his mind. And so this eulogy, I had to be intellectual. I can't. So for all of y'all looking for a quick hoop and a shout, it ain't coming today. In respect and honor to the man that I eulogize. But I could talk about Genesis, and I could also go to the time in which in the Bible Adam declares and defines what time means to him, because he finally finds the right woman. And see, and there's this reality, y'all, that in all of us, we come to a moment in time where we recognize, we realize that there's something in this moment that I'm supposed to get. Bryant says it best when he says his thing was this. His thing was time, y'all. Yes. And what I did in my prayer, and I came to realize something, his thing was also found in the book of Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Yeah. The 10th verse. And watch this, and don't miss this. When you talk about his great education, when you talk about his commitment to armed service, when you talk about his work, don't miss this part about Brian, because as Yolanda said, it was his silent faith that made him the man that he was. That's why he didn't get into the loud, boisterous preaching, because he figured out some stuff. You ain't got to do all that. Come on. To live out and to be what God called you to be. Let that thing live out in you. Let that be the thing that speaks loud and profound to the people that you're around. But Yolanda, I found this in Hebrew, and this is what God gave me about Brian. Hebrew 11 and 10 says this, for he was looking forward to the city that has foundation, whose designer and builder is good, is God, I'm sorry. See, there are many things in this world we live in, y'all, that are built. Men wake up and they go to work after giving life to children and marrying a woman, and they look to build a great legacy. Women who go out and achieve accomplishments in education and career, they look back on their children hoping that they have built a great legacy. And all of those things, y'all, they exist for a time. And the reality for you and me is that if we don't have faith in God, if we don't believe, as Pastor said, then your living is in vain. Your living is in vain. There's a story in the Bible, because again, I just want to keep this simple. Story in the Bible, and some of us who went to Sunday school, you know this story of a young man that they call the prodigal son. And this is the text I want to take for this eulogy, and again, I'll be out your way. But this is what jumped out to me. Luke 15:20 in the New Living Translation says this, so he returned home to his father. That's it. Just a matter of time. Before all of us in this room will have to return home to our father. Now, I understand, again, if I got some deep theological folks in here, Justin, I understand the story. You know, the story, the narrative of Luke 15 is that, you know, there was this young boy who was found himself in a pit. And in the Bible says that he came to himself. But now he got in the pit because he made some decisions. And again, watch this. This is not for Brian. This is for somebody who's in a pit. Don't miss that. I just got to be transparent with y'all because, again, I got the green light in prayer when I asked God about what to say on behalf of his man. The narrative says that he was in a pit and he came to himself. And there's somebody in here that God wants you to understand. I know where you are, and watch this. Even though you're there, it does not change what I feel for you. But what God will do, y'all, in life is he'll put somebody in your path that, watch this, is able to be used as a beacon of light to show you how to walk away from the mess that you can get in. The profound moment was when his brother spoke about it. I went through this, but my brother showed me this. For everybody in here, there's a Bryant in your life. Somebody that God uses to get you to understand, like in Hebrew, that you got to realize that he is the designer and the builder. But the unfortunate part, especially those of us who got a good black education, we think we too smart for God. We think we know too much about life, and we don't need to heed what God said. We'll subscribe to what man gives us, and we'll reject what the Bible tells you. I got to be Baptist for a minute. You cannot deny what Scripture tells you about how you should live. And then watch this. If Brian's testimony was real to you, then you need to understand everything he did was because of what he had read in here. He didn't come up with it on his own. He didn't pick it up and start building his own thing. He was raised up on a foundation that gave him this word, that showed him how to live out this word. And so watch this. If you love him, if he's your favorite uncle, if he was your best friend, then as a man and a woman, then you need to pick this thing up and understand everything that it says you're supposed to do while you're here on earth, because that's the legacy that this man left for you and me. Bible says he returned home to his father. Now here's the shot. If you keep reading verse 20, it says, and while he was still a long way off, his father saw him. Yeah. I'm like Hoover back, but I'm not going to show how fine. I ain't a Hoover. Watch this. Here's the beauty about God. I need to encourage somebody. Here's the beauty about God in chapter 20, in verse 20. Watch this. You can make your way home. But understand this, the whole time that you're walking from wherever you are to get to him, he's always watching you. The beauty about God is that's why the word tells you, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. How can somebody say that unless they're watching you? Quit thinking that the path you're walking, though, the lane that you're driving down is a lane that you picked and a lane that you set. You better realize the moment you came up with the idea to be an advertiser, to be in marketing, to be a writer, or to be an engineer, or to be a scientist, watch this. You better understand the one that put you on that street was God himself. The Bible tells you that every idea, origin of thought that came here on earth started with God. The thing that confuses it, the thing that twists it, is that you and I, because we are filled with sin, have to fight through the sin to get to the divine and the plan and wishes that God has for us in the life we're supposed to live. The Bible says, lean not to your own understanding. understanding, but trust in the Lord with your own heart. And to somebody, that's God's word to you today. Stop trying to do this thing your way and be like Brian and lean on me. I don't know who you are. I don't know where you're sitting right now. But the reality is in this story, and for you to be sitting here, God wants you to hear this story, is that wherever you are right now, he's watching you. Yeah. And the only thing you got to do is get up from wherever you are and make your way to him. Watch this. And with extended arms and an open heart, he will receive you. He ain't going to be worried about what you've been through. Amen. He ain't going to be thinking about what you did. Because all he wants is his child to come back home. Thing about Brian that I learned was that he was that kind of person. No matter how many headaches you gave him, no matter how much he didn't agree with something you did, the doors was always open. The eyes for you to walk through the doors were always on the door. Why? Because the God that was in him had to live out that way. While he was lying way off, the Father saw him coming. But watch this, this is the key for somebody. Because I'm sure there's somebody intellectual, Justin, in here, saying, well, why would a father look out or look somewhere? And it's in verse 20, Justin. You ready? I got to talk to you now, Justin. We disciple together. Watch this, Justin. New Living Translator said this. He was looking at the son. And the reason why he could look was this reason here. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. That went over the audience. Let me go back to my friend, because man, you about to have church. Watch this. Story says this man, whose son made some decisions that put him in a bad place, had an awakening. And the awakening moment, watch this, while the father was looking for him, when he finally saw him, the Bible says that the father, filled with love and compassion, did something that's important for everybody in this room. He ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. I got to give you an analogy real quick, because some of y'all might didn't go to Sunday school and you didn't get this. Watch this. If you know your culture and time, then you understand the man that was looking for his son had on a long garment like me. If you know your Bible, Mia, then you also know that for this man to get off of his porch and run to his son, for the folks looking, Lewin, watching, he became a disgrace and an embarrassment. The embarrassment, Mia, was because to get to his son, I don't know if you ever wore one of these robes before, Mia, but you can't run in this thing. It ain't like a running suit. That thing kind of hinders you. It stops you. To get to him, homie, he had to pull up his skirt, and he had to run. Get to his son. The shout in the text, though, is the fact that his daddy loved him enough that to embarrass himself, he would run to his son. Didn't matter what the neighborhood said, didn't matter what the folks was thinking, he loved his son that much that he lifted his skirt and ran to his son. Now I'm done here. This is where you shout at. The same father that walks in heaven, his will would be done. One day on Calvary to lift up his skirt. And for you and me, God, he ran. Why? Because he was filled with compassion and because he loved you. And that's the God that Brian's faith was filled on. That's the God that pushed him to love you the way that he loved you. And I'm going to say to somebody, be he waiting because the skirt has already been lifted. Everybody on your feet. Lord God, thank you for lifting it up. Thank you for loving us enough to run to us. But thank you most of all for showing yourself to Bryant. So for those of us that didn't go into the temple, for those of us that don't like church, he could be a living example that could be used to bring us to church. And even in death, God, who he is still points back to you. And so, God, it is because of that that we give you honor and we give you glory. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
were four rows in the middle. Everybody standing all over the building except for the four rows in the front of the middle. Now that you're standing, we ask you to follow the direction of the ushers. This is the time when the family would like to view the body for themselves, by themselves, a private view. You've had your opportunity. Now they want to do theirs alone. And we know that some come for support, but I can be real and I can say that some come just to be spectators. We don't need spectators at this time. We need them to be able to spend their last minutes alone with their loved one. So follow, please follow the directions of the usher. When you get outside, please don't stand at the door in the hallway. Go to your vehicle and remain in your vehicle. If you're going to the gravesite, go to your vehicle and wait there. Let us honor Brian this last time and be punctual.
Kill us, don't stop recording.
It's just
and know your family. But we have a list. Please understand. Please. Well, excuse me, I just want to make sure, okay? I have to follow her instructions.